Hello students, today we will do poem number 6 of first flight, that is Amanda. Dear students, the greatest wealth that a child wants to possess is the freedom. A child never likes constant nagging, unwanted instructions and overprotection of the parents. Amanda is the story of a young girl who is constantly controlled and instructed to do one thing or the other by her parents. We all know that childhood is a period when children indulge in fantasies. But when they start growing up, their parents expect them to behave more responsibly. What they do is, they start nagging and giving instructions at every step. Children never want to be instructed and guided the way their parents want. What they feel is that if the parents are curtailing their freedom, they are being nagged. If parents keep on nagging their children, then probably their children escape to the dreamy world of fantasies and they don't want to come out of this fanciful world so early. The poem Amanda is all about this. Let us have an introduction to the lesson. This poem is written by Robert Kleene. Robert Kleene has expressed the views of a little girl whose name is Amanda, who is constantly pointed out by her mother for making mistakes. Mistakes which she considers so as they are not part of the code of good conduct laid out by the society in which we live. So before we start with the poem, let us have a look at the brief summary of what all the poem is about. The poem describes a girl named Amanda and her mother who is nagging her for mistakes. She is first pointed out by her mother for biting her nails and for not sitting in the right posture. The mother also feels that Amanda sits in a very lazy manner. To this, Amanda imagines herself as a mermaid who lives a calm and relaxing life in the beautiful green sea. Further, she is nagged for not cleaning her room and shoes and also for not doing her homework. She then imagines herself to be an orphan because she is now fed up of being watched by her parents continuously. She says that she would have enjoyed her freedom then by making the patterns of her bare feet on the sand and would live a peaceful life. Next, again, Amanda is scolded for eating too many chocolates, which may cause pimples. She is also scolded for not listening to her mother. So, now Amanda thinks of being Rapunzel, a character from a fairy tale, and wants to live in a huge tower like her. In the tower, she'll be all alone and will live a peaceful life and will never allow anyone to come in. Finally, the mother asks her to stop being moody because she doesn't want anyone to blame her for harassing her daughter. At this time, the poet has not written any reaction from Amanda's side. This constant nagging has made her so sad that she has even stopped to imagine herself as someone else. She used to do so in order to escape from the continuous harassment and dominance of her parents. So students, now let us start with the poem Amanda as given in your book. So in the first verse, we see that Amanda is being instructed by her mother. She is getting the instructions from her mother. Don't bite your nails, Amanda. Don't Don't hunch your shoulders, Amanda. Stop that slouching and sit up straight, Amanda. But the next verse shows that Amanda is lost in her imagination. There is a languid emerald sea where the sole inhabitant is me, a mermaid drifting blissfully. But then again we see Amanda is again being instructed by her mother. Did you finish your homework, Amanda? Did you tidy your room, Amanda? I thought I told you to clean your shoes, Amanda. But then again, we see that Amanda is lost in her imaginary world, imagining herself as an orphan. I am an orphan roaming the street. I pattern soft dust with my hushed bare feet. The silence is golden, the freedom is sweet. Then again, instructions come from the mother. Don't eat that chocolate, Amanda. Remember your acne, Amanda. Will you please look at me when I'm speaking to you, Amanda? Again, she's in the world of fairyland. I am Rapunzel. I have not a care. Life in a tower is tranquil and rare. I'll certainly never let down my bright hair. So again we see, the mother says, stop that sulking at once, Amanda. You're always so moody, Amanda. Anyone would think that I nagged at you, Amanda. So this is all about the poem. Let us start with the explanation part now. This is the first verse of the poem. Don't bite your nails, Amanda. Don't hunch your shoulders, Amanda. Stop that slouching and sit up straight, Amanda. Hunch means to bend the upper body forward. You can see here in the picture, when your upper body, you're bending it forward, that is hunch. And slouching means to move lazily. Here we see that Amanda is biting her nails. So her mother asks her not to do so. Nor does the mother want that she should hunch her shoulders down. She wants her to sit straight, because Amanda seems to be drooping her body towards one side. But her mother wants her to adopt a right posture and sit up straight. In the second verse, we see that Amanda is lost here in her imagination. There is a languid emerald sea where the sole inhabitant is me, a mermaid drifting blissfully. Languid here means relaxed, and drifting means moving slowly. Students, here what we have to note is that these lines are given within brackets, and brackets are used to provide more meaning to the phrase. Here the poet uses it to present the imagination of the little girl, the free flow of pure thoughts. Amanda uses her imagination as an escape point from day-to-day commands of her parents, because she just wants, because if parents keep on nagging their children, so what happens? Their children escape to the dreamy world of fantasies, and they don't want to come out of this fanciful world so early. So Amanda, in the same way, she feels very much suffocated in the real world and thus finds peace in her very own created world, where there are no restraints, no restrictions. She imagines herself to be a joyful mermaid sailing without any confines. This world of Amanda is all free and contained in itself, and her happiness does not require any other human being. And for a child, mermaid hair is a symbol of freedom and wonder. Actually, mermaid, what is mermaid? It is an imaginary sea creature having a woman's head and body with a fish tail instead of legs. Here you can see in the picture also. So here what Amanda doesn't bother what her mother wants. She is lost in her own dreamy world, and she imagines as if she were in a very quiet and relaxing island, and there is no one there except her, and there she moves around freely and blissfully like a mermaid. So then again the instructions come from the mother. Did you finish your homework, Amanda? Did you tidy your room, Amanda? I thought I told you to clean your shoes, Amanda. So Amanda's mother asks if she has finished her homework, if she has made her room clean, and Amanda has not cleaned her shoes yet. Her mother has already asked her to clean her shoes. So dear students, Amanda is being disciplined for every little thing, making her lose of her freedom. Her innocence is eventually getting lost with the passage of time. The way these instructions are delivered points out the regular nature of these lessons. Her name being called again with an exclamation mark shows that the parents seem to be losing their cool and are troubled. So again we see that she is lost in her own world and says, I am an orphan roaming the street. I pattern soft dust with my hushed bare feet. The silence is golden, the freedom is sweet. Pattern means to make patterns. Hushed is quiet, bare is uncovered, something, you know, not clothed. And orphan, a child whose parents are either dead or gone missing. So in this stanza, students, we once again see that Amanda's reactions to her mother's harsh words. Amanda again withdraws into another imaginary world. The very first line is awfully depressing, where Amanda imagines herself to be an orphan, suggesting how much frustrated, how much irritated she is with the continuous questioning of her parents, especially her mother. She has no shoes on her feet, and instead she is getting them even dirtier by making designs on the dusty ground with them. However, she makes no sound while making these dusty designs. She cherishes the silence as well as the freedom to do as she likes that world of her imagination. Her love for silence is as a result of the shouting and yelling of her parents. And the freedom which she is enjoying, she considers this freedom as very, very sweet. Then again, she gets instructions from the mother. Don't eat that chocolate, Amanda. Remember your acne, Amanda. Will you please look at me when I'm speaking at you, Amanda? Acne here means pimple which occur due to oily skin. So students, the set of instructions provided here indicate how much essential it is for Amanda to understand the value of external beauty as well, and the steps to be taken to preserve it from a very tender age. Because here we see that Amanda is being stopped by her parents from eating a chocolate, as previously that had caused her acne. Here we see how a child is made conscious of a natural experience such as pimples. But however, Amanda is still lost in her own thoughts and doesn't care enough to look up to her scolding parents. Because here we see that Amanda does not bother what her mother is saying, nor does she look at her mother when she is giving her instructions. The mother expects her to look towards her while she is speaking. But again we see that she is lost in the land of fury. Now she says, I am Rapunzel. I have not a care. Life in a tower is tranquil and rare. I'll certainly never let down my bright hair. Tranquil here means calm. Now, Rapunzel is the name of a German fairy tale character who was made to live alone in a high tower and had very long, beautiful golden hair. She was held captive by a witch, Dame Godel, who used to come up to the tower by climbing her long hair. The only way one could make a contact with her was only using her long hair. This is all about Rapunzel. So now again we see that Amanda does not care a bit what her mother says, because she is again lost in her dreamy world, in her imaginative world. She imagines herself as a Rapunzel who is living in a lonely tower. In that tower, life is free from all cares, and it is rare peace and tranquility that prevails there all the time. Tranquil means calmness. And she is proud of her beautiful hair, as Rapunzel was. She will certainly never let down her bright hair like her. So dear students, here what we see is that Amanda doesn't want her peace to be disturbed anyhow, and she wanted to live as a free and happy person. Stop that sulking once, Amanda. You're always so moody, Amanda. Anyone would think that I nagged at you, Amanda. Sulking is to be upset and nagged is scolded. Here the parents keep instructing Amanda on the do's and don'ts, but Amanda remains lost in her own dreams. The parents believe that Amanda is not reacting because she is annoyed. Amanda's behavior has made her parents look bad, and they are worried about their image. They are concerned about how society will perceive them if their child always remains in a bad or in a foul mood. They want to prove themselves as a responsible parent who manage to balance out what the child wants and what the society expects out of Amanda. However, they have already failed in their efforts. So we see that Amanda's mother is asking her not to sulk or feel unhappy anymore, and she feels that Amanda is always moody and keeps on behaving like that, and she must stop sulking and feel unhappy. Otherwise, what people will think is that Amanda is unhappy just because her mother is always nagging at her. So this is all about the poem. So if I talk about the central idea of the poem, students, here we'll see that the poem deals with the upbringing of a small girl, Amanda, and it highlights the struggles faced by the child. Poet Robin Kleene makes an important point that a child should never be denied freedom. And though it is parents who are responsible for proper upbringing of their child, but that should not make a child feel trapped. Here Amanda is prepared to be acceptable in society, and this training needs her freedom to be cut short. Her imagination is not given enough space, thus making her so angry that she wishes to be an orphan, and the continuous nagging, that is continuous fault fighting, has thus made her moody. So now let us see what all poetic devices are being used in the lesson. First poetic device that we can see here is the alliteration. What is alliteration? Alliteration is repetition of initial consonant sounds in the same line. For example, I can see in the same line, S sound is being repeated here. In stop, slouching, sit and straight, S sound is being repeated. The next poetic device is anaphora. That means repetition of the words in the beginning. For example, in the beginning of the sentence, we can see don't and don't. It is being repeated in the consecutive two lines. Then we have assonance as well. And assonance is repetition of the vowels.
Here we can see a O vowel is being repeated in the second line. In your, O is used, shoulders, O is used. So the vowels are being repeated. And then we have repetition, one of the poetic devices. Amanda is being repeated in first and second line here. Then we have allusion. Students, what is allusion? Allusion is a reference to a statement, a reference to a person, a reference to a place, or a reference to any of the imaginary character which we take. It could be either from history we have taken, or from religion, literature, or any other field. For example, in the chapter we here see mermaid, and another is Rapunzel. Mermaid is a free and contained in their own, that is taken from the fairy tales, and Rapunzel, who lived all alone on a tower for a long time, that was a part of Germany, a German fairy tale. And mermaid we have taken from the fairy tales, and Rapunzel also we have taken from a part of German fairy tales. Then we have metaphor. Metaphor is a device which compares two things or qualities which are unlike. For example, here we see emerald sea. See the color of the sea, rather than saying that the sea is green, emerald, it is a stone which is of green color, is being, you know, used here just to denote that the sea was all green. Then we have anaphora again, did and did, to it is being repeated. Then we have assonance again, the repetition of the vowels. In the third line we can see in thought, told, you, to, your, shoes, O vowel is being repeated. And again we have metaphor here. The silence is gold, the freedom is sweet. Metaphor again, we have the comparison of two things or qualities which are unlike. Then again we have allusion here, a reference to the imaginary character which is being taken from the fairy tale. Here we have consonants. Consonants means repetition of the consonant sound. In the third line we can see in never, R is being used. In bright, R is used. In hair, R is used. So R consonant is being used repeatedly. So this is the consonants. So this is all about the poem, and just go through the video properly. In case if you have any confusion, any doubts or queries, that will be sorting out in the virtual session. Till then, goodbye everyone.